Hey YouTubers, this is the Gold Standard Season 924 coming at you with my WrestleMania 34 pay-per-view review. Now, this was a show that's definitely really hard to judge whether this was a pay-per-view that was spectacular, that it was out of this world. And then you also kind of get that feeling that maybe this pay-per-view wasn't really all that spectacular as it turns out to be. And I was definitely on the fence when I was processing everything that I could remember regarding about this pay-per-view event. I mean, I definitely enjoyed it in general. I mean, I was definitely having a good time just watching the pay-per-view, particularly like the first few hours of the show. And then like once you get to the last hour, it just kind of drains you out. Like for me personally, when you're just sitting watching a big time pay-per-view like WrestleMania, and it kind of gets to like the 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock hour, you know, I'm pretty much burnt out from the show. And it's definitely kind of that situation that's been going on for a few years now. And, you know, even I sort of had my gripes about that the previous year with WrestleMania 33. And I believe I did a review just making mention of that minor, or I guess you could say major, complaint that I have with this particular format that WWE has taken in recent years. And you know, you also even have to factor in WrestleMania weekend, because you also have all these festivities going on. With Friday, you had the WWE Hall of Fame ceremony, and then the following day it's NXT TakeOver, which was actually a really great show. I definitely really enjoyed it, but I don't follow NXT on a consistent basis to really do a honest pay-per-view review regarding about the wrestlers and the stories heading into NXT TakeOver. I mean, I wish I could, you know, go into detail regarding about a review of NXT TakeOver New Orleans and just kind of give out my thoughts on it. So, I mean, I definitely really enjoyed that show, but I just can't really get around to do that review at the moment. But it was definitely a really great show, and it definitely showed that when it came to WrestleMania, in terms of just the overall experience watching a show like NXT and then going into like WrestleMania, so that was also a big challenge for me to go ahead and like watch this big time pay-per-view that's been built up as the grandest stage of them all, the showcase of the immortals, just so many monikers that WrestleMania has gone by since its inception in 1985. So nevertheless, now we also have the pre-show as well, which goes on for 2 hours, and then, you know, the regular show being 4 to 5 hours. So it's definitely a lot of wrestling to really sit through. And then, you know, Raw and SmackDown the following 2 days, so I was just completely burnt out. But yeah, WrestleMania 34, it's definitely a show that was very difficult for me to really get a general statement or like my general reaction, whether the pay-per-view was good, whether it was bad, yada yada yada. We do have the pre-show, which I normally don't really go into detail too much about, but just what you need to know, there were two battle royals, the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal, as well as the first ever Women's Memorial Battle Royal. Now originally it was the Fabulous Moolah Battle Royal, but after the circumstances surrounding the allegations surrounding Fabulous Moolah, so with some of the complaints that Snickers had received since they were the sponsors for WrestleMania that year, so they had to change the name of the Battle Royal and just be sort of more of an appreciation of just women's wrestling as far as the motif behind the Battle Royal solely devoted towards women's wrestling, as opposed to just a memorial Battle Royal for a particular figure that contributed to women's wrestling, if that makes sense. But we did have Matt Hardy winning the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. He did, however, had some assistance from Bray Wyatt. Bray and Matt had been feuding back and forth. They had that total deletion that happened on Monday Night Raw, so Matt Hardy, with the help of Jeff Hardy, helped defeat Bray Wyatt. So Wyatt was pretty much out of action for a few weeks, and then he came back, he partners up with Matt Hardy, and thus it seemed like going forward that Matt and Bray will become a tag team. And I'll get a little more into the Raw's tag team division as the video rolls along, but Matt Hardy did, however, win the Andre the Giant Battle Royal this year. We also have a tournament to crown a new Cruiserweight champion. Cedric Alexander going over Mustafa Ali to become the Cruiserweight champion. And we also have the Women's Memorial Battle Royal, which Naomi won. So now we get over to the main card of the show. And the match that opened up the show was the triple threat for the Intercontinental Championship. Miz going in as champion, defending the belt against Finn Balor, and as well as Seth Rollins. Now, I definitely really enjoyed this match. I think it was a smart move on WWE's part to really open up the show with the fast-paced action. It definitely really delivered. There was amazing somersault plancha that Balor did on both Miz and Rollins. Seth Rollins also did a superplex on both the wrestlers as well, so I thought that was pretty cool. He could finally even do the curb stomp, which he had been starting to do again in recent months. So I got sick and tired of seeing Rollins doing the freaking pedigree all the time, since his pedigree's not as spectacular compared to Triple H's. Yeah, I mean, this match was definitely fast-paced, and Rollins tried to do that not necessarily the turnbuckle powerbomb. I was going to mention the powerbomb to the barricade, the one that, you know, that he was doing with to Finn Balor that caused him to get sidelined, but Balor countered that move eventually. Yeah, so there was definitely moments where you feel like, you know, a certain wrestler was going to walk out of this match as the champion. Yeah, so Rollins did, however, manage to pick up the victory here and became the new Intercontinental Champion, as well as making him the 19th Grand Slam champion. And now we get to the SmackDown Live Women's Championship. Charlotte Flair going as the champion, taking on Asuka. Asuka won the first ever Women's Royal Rumble match to earn a shot at a Women's Championship belt of her own. It's a similar situation that they did during the initial brand split, where you had the winner of the Royal Rumble given an opportunity to decide which championship belt of which respective brand would they be going after. In this case with Asuka, is she going to go after the Raw Women's title, or is she going to be going after the SmackDown Women's title? And it turns out that after a month or two, Asuka chooses her sight on Charlotte to go after the SmackDown Women's title. So this is actually definitely a really good match, and there was just a lot of back and forth submission holds here and there. They were just trying to kind of outsmart one another. So it's definitely a very hard fought bout. Charlotte did like an amazing moonsault like she normally does, but there was also a move that she did. It was sort of like that move that Paul Burchill did in WWE when he was doing that Jack Sparrow gimmick. I'm not sure if anyone remembers that gimmick, or let alone the wrestler himself. But his finisher was, I believe it was called Walking the Plank, and he would do like this sort of like moonsault. Like, he would set his opponents up for like a rock bottom or something, and then he would just do like this backflip. It's basically kind of like that. Charlotte definitely really pulled off some of the best spots of that match. Not to take anything away from Asuka. Asuka did it looked like she was doing a Hell's Gate, the move that Undertaker does, or it was like a triangle choke. And then at some point, Charlotte Flair also did a Walls of Jericho. What really shocked me the most was Charlotte going over Asuka. It definitely really caught me by surprise. And because I thought that they were going to go with the predictable route and having Asuka defeat Charlotte and walk out as the new women's champion. But it turns out that wasn't the case. So they had Charlotte go over Asuka. They had her break the streak. And this is the second WrestleMania, the second pay-per-view in the same venue. The Undertaker streak had ended thanks to Brock Lesnar. So this is a similar situation here with Asuka. So I thought going into this, like, Asuka was going to walk out as the champion, especially given how the WWE has presented Asuka as this undefeated competitor. You know, she had been making her mark on NXT, being the longest reigning NXT Women's Champion. Then she had to get sidelined due to an injury, but they did, however, bring her to the main roster on Monday Night Raw. So they were kind of continuing that undefeated streak, and they just kind of play it up like it's a big deal. She wins that Royal Rumble match, and then she gets this opportunity to challenge the Women's Champion on SmackDown, being Charlotte, at, you know, a big stage like WrestleMania. And to see her lose that match in front of capacity crowd, it just really astounded me. It'd be like if Goldberg had spent 7 to 8 months going after all the lower tier wrestlers and then the mid card guys, winning the US title, and then he gets booked to challenge Hulk Hogan, only to just lose to him cleanly in Atlanta. So imagine if that happened. It just kind of felt very questionable on my part, like not pulling the trigger on Asuka that way. Is she like buried by any stretch? I don't think so. Could this situation be salvaged? I think so. Because maybe they could bring up this whole like story that maybe Asuka came into this pay-per-view very cocky, overconfident. Maybe she underestimated Charlotte, and there was just so much expectations that are high above her shoulders. Like there's just so much like anticipation that maybe once Asuka got to the point where she just feels like very overconfident that nothing can stop her, all of a sudden it just kind of collapses. It crashes and burns. And maybe they could play that up, like as far as Asuka as to why she lost the match, that maybe it's not so much necessarily that it was Charlotte that broke the streak, but maybe it's more the fact that maybe Asuka's her own worst enemy. Maybe she got too cocky along the way, and that kind of got to the point where she ended up losing in that match and allowing, Charlotte and underestimating her opponent. Charlotte managed to be one step ahead of her. And thus, we all saw what happened that Sunday. So I definitely think that Asuka could definitely really get her back on her feet, even without the streak being intact. I think they do have a potential good storyline that I think that could really enhance Asuka as a character moving forward. I honestly think that Asuka should have won the women's title, but am I upset about it? Not really. But could it be salvage? I think so. And Charlotte did, however, manage to retain the women's title. Eventually, if you watch SmackDown, she did, however, lose the belt to Carmella since she was cashing in Money in the Bank that night and thus subsequently making herself the new women's champion in the process. Why Carmella didn't interfere in that match, even though it would have been so obvious that she could have when she had the chance. And it'll definitely be interesting to see what will happen with Asuka moving forward. And now we get to the Fatal 4-Way, and this is for the United States Championship. Randy Orton defending the belt against Jinder Mahal, Bobby Roode, and Rusev. Now, this was not a very long match. It was actually pretty disappointing. I mean, Rusev was really white hot going in this match, and they've been doing this whole campaign about how every day is going to be Rusev Day. And, I mean, Rusev's just been kind of in an up and down slope throughout the past few years. I mean, when Rusev was brought in, he was basically undefeated. And then he had his program with John Cena. He loses the US title. And then he was just kind of going through a rocky road along the way. And then he got squashed by Randy Orton earlier that summer. He, however, did recover from this particular losing streak, I guess you could say. It's definitely really paying off. I mean, the crowd's been eating it up the past several months, and having a spokesperson like Aiden English being in his corner has really done wonders for him. We also have, Bobby Roode, who was just called up to the main roster, and he even won the US title in a tournament. But he did, however, lose it to Randy Orton the previous pay-per-view at Fastlane. And then you also have Jinder Mahal, who had been the WWE champion last year, and ironically, he and Orton were feuding throughout that summer for that title. And now both of them have been relegated into this mid-card position, and all these four competitors are kind of all involved in this whole debacle for quite some time. But yeah, I mean, this match didn't go on for very long. I didn't mind who was going to win as long as it wasn't Jinder Mahal. But Jinder did, however, win this match, which was the last thing I wanted going in this match. And he pinned Rusev, the hottest wrestler of the SmackDown brand, to walk out of the match and become the new United States champion. And yeah, I mean, this match didn't go on for long, like I said, but it was definitely very disappointing. And, you know, Randy Orton's been kind of winding down in his wrestling career. I mean, he had been on top as world champion multiple times, and now he's been kind of going through that, like, particular position that Chris Benoit and Eddie Guerrero went through the last few years of their careers, where they were on top one year, and then next thing you know, they kind of dropped down a bit. Even though they are still presented as a big deal. Orton held that belt for about a month or about like a few weeks just to drop it to Jinder Mahal. But now Orton's going after Jinder Mahal for the US title at Backlash. They did a triple threat on SmackDown to determine the number one contender. But yeah, it's, you know, with the Orton Mahal program, I mean, the last time I saw, I mean, those matches just really stunk up the joint. I mean, they just doesn't feel as like Orton and Mahal have any sort of like great chemistry by any means. And now we have to witness this particular program being revisited again. So I don't want to go into too much detail regarding about that debacle with Orton and Mahal, but yeah, I mean, this match just was pretty disappointing out of the bunch. And Mahal did, however, walk out as the new US champion. I believe the next match that came afterwards was the mixed tag match with Triple H and Stephanie McMahon taking on Kurt Angle and Ronda Rousey. This is Kurt's first WrestleMania since WrestleMania 22, so it was great to see Kurt Angle back on the WrestleMania stage again. Triple H and Stephanie are also involved in this match as well, so they have Ronda Rousey, a former MMA fighter of USC. So they brought her in to WWE, the Royal Rumble after the match. You know, she came out, made her presence known, and this kind of foreshadowed or at least provoked a rivalry between Ronda and Stephanie. Ronda signs a contract around Elimination Chamber time. It's definitely been a heated rivalry for the past few years, actually, but I mean, this was definitely a moment where Ronda Rousey broke Stephanie's arm at WrestleMania 31, and then they kind of brought this particular feud back on again once Ronda officially signs with WWE. Now we get to have that actual match in some way, shape, or form, this being a mixed tag team match. And it definitely really surprised me, as well as a lot of folks. I mean, the crowd was really eating it up. I mean, not a single person was sitting in the crowd. I mean, the crowd was just eating it up. I mean, there was just so much suspense going on back and forth that you can't really tell who was going to actually win this match. You know, there was just moments where, I'm trying to think, but there were like moments where like Kurt Angle and Ronda Rousey, as far as I can remember, they were locking in their respective submission holds. So in this case, Kurt Angle was doing the ankle lock, Ronda Rousey was doing like a cross arm breaker on Triple H and Stephanie. And it looked like they were going to tap out, but it turns out that they didn't. So the match kind of continued on. Ronda Rousey did get her moment here and being responsible for making Stephanie tap out. It was definitely just a huge back and forth match with a lot of suspense added to it. The crowd was really hot. I was really invested. Stephanie McMahon actually did really good in this match. So it really showed just, you know, even though she's like not necessarily an actual wrestler, but it kind of really shows that she had, you know, she knew like hold for hold, just the fundamentals, you know, going into this match. So, I mean, for all the flack that a lot of the internet wrestling community have given to her over the years, and, you know, I've had my fair share of annoyance with Stephanie over the years as well, but I'll give credit where credit's its due, and she didn't do this bad in this match. Same with Ronda Rousey. I think going into this that people were unsure whether Ronda could work, you know, like in a professional wrestling environment as opposed to, you know, mixed martial arts. You know, even despite the scenery change, it really seems like she's really adjusting pretty well. I definitely really enjoyed this match, and definitely really the highlight of the night. So that should actually tell you something there. The triple threat tag, and this was for the SmackDown Live Tag Team Championships. The Usos defending the belts against the New Day, as well as the Bludgeon Brothers. Now, this was actually a gimmick that they've been doing also for the past several months with Luke Harper and Eric Rowan, who were once part of the Wyatt family. But yeah, I mean, they've been kind of presenting the Bludgeon Brothers as this powerhouse tag team that's kind of setting the world on fire, at least in the tag team division, I should say.
Yeah, I'm not really fond of that gimmick personally. It's definitely really not the type of gimmicks that I would expect from Harper and Rowan, but they're definitely making the most out of it. But for me, it's just not really catching on. But yeah, so they've had the Bludgeon Brothers basically demolish the Usos in the New Days another series of tag team title matches that they had. And, you know, they had the match at Fastlane, which ended in a no contest. So that was used as kind of a way to set up this particular program here at WrestleMania. So they had the Bludgeon Brothers actually going over and become the new SmackDown Live Tag Team Champions. But yeah, I mean, this match was just kind of one of those matches that you just kind of want to use as a way to sort of like quiet the crowd. I mean, especially since they were kind of still in that, in awe of what they saw with the mixed tag team match. So it was kind of like after that, it's like, how do you follow up on that? So it was definitely put in that particular position where it had no chance of really living up to that hype that the previous match had to endure. But Harper and Rowan did, however, win this match and become the new SmackDown Tag Team Champions. Then we have, I believe it's another tag team match. Oh my god. I mean, I didn't realize, like, for all these WrestleManias that we had in recent years, I didn't realize just how heavily centric with all these multi-man matches are concerned. It's definitely reminding me a little bit of WrestleMania 2000 to some extent, but I mean, there was like only one particular singles match, and everything else was like all multi-person or multi-man matches, like triple threats, fatal four-ways, multi-man tags, like six-man tags, and hardcore battle royal. In WrestleMania 34, there was just a lot of that going on, but we do have a few singles matches here, so it's not just completely all multi-man matches here. We also have Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon taking on Kevin Owens and Sami Zayn. Now, Daniel Bryan did, however, make his return to the ring in, I want to say, 3 years. And basically, you know, Bryan had to announce his retirement once it turns out that one of the doctors, I should say, did not clear Daniel Bryan in 2016, so therefore he had to retire. So he serves his duties on SmackDown once they brought the brand extension back. So they had him serve as the SmackDown general manager, whereas Shane McMahon would serve as the commissioner of that show. And this kind of had this they both had this program going on with Owens and Zayn once they came over to SmackDown just over a year ago, I think during that Superstar shakeup the previous year. And there's been kind of this rift going on between Owens and Shane that's been going on for as long as it ended up happening. And then Sami Zayn kind of gets involved in this mix and costing Shane McMahon the match, turning heel during that Hell in a Cell match and helping Kevin Owens win. They've been kind of going back and forth. This is like the longest feud that I could remember going on in recent memory. And, you know, Bryan kind of got into this mix as well. And I think there was like a match at the December pay-per-view. Bryan and Shane were like playing double guest referees, and they were kind of basically kind of been at each other's throats, but then they ended up being on good terms again. And so they pair up at WrestleMania taking on Owens and Sami Zayn once it turns out that Bryan was indeed in fact clear to wrestle once again. So they put him in this tag team match, and this has been the culmination of everything that's been going on the past 12 months or so. And yeah, the crowd definitely really ate it up. This was the same show that Bryan won his WWE World Heavyweight title in that triple threat match at WrestleMania 30. So definitely really bring him back at the perfect time. And yeah, the crowd was just as hot as they were with Bryan as much as they were 4 years ago. And it wasn't a bad match. Definitely really enjoyed it. And the whole idea of just seeing like Bryan going out there and definitely kicking ass like he used to do, and it still shows that he could. So Bryan and Shane, however, go over Owens and Sami Zayn, likely ending this year-long feud that's been ongoing. And it's definitely great to see Bryan back in the WWE ring, or at least in the professional wrestling ring in general. And now that Bryan is wrestling once again, it turns out that Shane McMahon ends up appointing a new SmackDown general manager with Paige. Hopefully he becomes careful this time, because he does like a lot of very risky moves, like especially with those diving headbutts that he's been doing that's been causing all these concussions. And hopefully Bryan stays safe and definitely change up his move set a bit to kind of lighten his workload and not necessarily taking too much risky bumps to the point where he has to retire once again and having to go through all this physical trauma that had him retiring the first time around. But hopefully he becomes careful this time. Nevertheless, I definitely really enjoyed this match, and it's great to see Bryan back again. And then we get to the WWE Championship bout with AJ Styles defending the belt against Shinsuke Nakamura. Shinsuke won the Men's Battle Royal, so he challenges AJ Styles, who, after a series of pay-per-views, manages to hold on to that title. So he's going as the champion, taking on Shinsuke Nakamura. Now, they've been hyping up this match, or at least like going into this pay-per-view, that with AJ Styles being the champion, that this is going to be like this all-time classic. He just puts it over. It's like it's you and me. It's babyface versus babyface. It's two of the top fan favorite wrestlers of SmackDown colliding in this one-on-one bout. The match, I mean, it was definitely a solid match in some ways, but it was also a match that I think a lot of people were kind of disappointed about. But I mean, I actually enjoyed this match. I personally think this was really, in my opinion, where this WrestleMania peaked, and it really showed definitely during this match. And it took a while for it to, really get rolling and whatnot. But once it started picking up, that I think that's really where it started. Like Shinsuke was doing his submission hold, and they're all doing what they can to kind of outsmart one another and countering each other's submission holds. And like AJ Styles did a calf crusher, Shinsuke countered with a triangle choke of his own. I don't think it has anything to do with them having a lack of chemistry, but I think it's just when it came to the build up to the show, like they just really wanted to set the bar high and try to claim to the viewers at home just time and time again that this is going to be an all-time classic. So I think they definitely really got viewers as far as getting their hopes up, setting the bar high, setting their expectations too high, that once you get to this particular match, I think people were just left with that maybe have enjoyed the match to a certain degree, but just weren't like in awe as far as, oh my God, I can't believe it. That's going to be the greatest match I've ever seen. So I think that was kind of, I think that played a part in the diminishing quality of the match, in my opinion. But I mean, I enjoyed it. AJ Styles did, however, go over Shinsuke with the Styles Clash and retaining the WWE title, much like in the situation with Asuka. I thought Shinsuke was going to walk out as the champion, but turns out that wasn't the case. After the match, what really caught me off guard was Shinsuke low blowing AJ Styles, and the crowd was like really in shock at the end. And it was sort of harkening back to WrestleMania 19, where after HBK and Jericho had their match, it looked like Jericho was going to go face, but then he just low blows HBK out of nowhere. I mean, that definitely reminded me of that particular moment. But here, Shinsuke, who was a face going into this match, ended up turning heel in the process and low blowing AJ Styles despite giving him that sportsmanship handshake. They're likely going to follow up with another series of matches at Backlash, only this time Shinsuke's the heel and AJ's the pure babyface. Nevertheless, I thought this match I definitely enjoyed. I think, in my opinion, this is really where this particular WrestleMania peaked, because after this, I mean, this show just kind of really went down the toilet pretty hard. The Raw Tag Team titles, Sheamus and Cesaro going as the champions, taking on Braun Strowman and a partner of his choosing. Now, going to this, I thought this might be a return of a particular wrestler. Maybe it could have been like Samoa Joe. I think, you know, Samoa Joe did, however, make his return the following Raw after WrestleMania. So, I mean, he was pretty much 100% healed by this point. So, why couldn't it have been Samoa Joe? Sheamus and Cesaro have been the primary focal point of the Raw tag division. And, you know, even though they've lost the belts a few times to Ambrose and Rollins, but they ended up, they ended up regaining the belts a number of times. They've been the focal point of the tag team division, and they've been defending those belts for quite some time. So Braun Strowman did, however, win a battle royal all by himself to determine the number one contenders for those tag titles. And they actually had a random person from the crowd to be Braun's partner. But it's not like, you know, with John Cena. Holy shit, I almost forgot about Undertaker versus Cena. But I'll get a little more into that as the video rolls along. Yeah, so Braun Strowman teams up with this 10-year-old kid named Nicholas, and in less effort, Braun Strowman manages to annihilate Sheamus and Cesaro in what pretty much felt more like a handicap match, if anything. Strowman just completely decimated Sheamus and Cesaro to, at least at the time, become the new Raw Tag Team Champions. After all the events that happened from WrestleMania that transpires over to Monday Night Raw, so Kurt declares the tag team title belts vacant, so they had to do a tag team eliminators match to determine who would face Sheamus and Cesaro for those tag titles. When I watched this match, I didn't have a problem with it. I was just kind of like laughing. I was having a blast. But the more I start to kind of process everything that happened, why did they even do this? Like a random kid, like not just a kid, but like just some random fan just comes in, and then all of a sudden you get to choose them out of all the wrestlers, all the active wrestlers. Like, you couldn't even pick someone from like NXT to come over and be Braun's partner to take on Sheamus and Cesaro. Or you couldn't pick like freaking a returning wrestler who was coming back from injury. What were they trying to accomplish? It was basically going to be like a one-time thing, so I don't expect like a non-active wrestler or like some random person from the crowd would be appointed to be Braun's partner and to expect them to like wrestle in a match, you know, especially for a fan that has like no wrestling experience whatsoever. Yeah, I mean, I know this match was basically for laughs. And it's something like you would expect from like Extreme Warfare Revenge if someone was like randomly booking this. It's like, hey, I'm gonna have like this 10-year-old kid and make him my tag team champion. I don't care that he has any wrestling experience or not. I don't care that he's not part of the roster or whichever the case that may be. In this particular idea or moment, I mean, I could honestly live without. It doesn't even help that the Universal title match with Brock Lesnar defending the belt against Roman Reigns, it didn't really help matters either. Crowd was just pretty bummed, and they just didn't really want to see this match. I mean, they didn't even want to see this main event or to close out the show. It may not speak for everybody, but like those particular, you know, wrestling fans that just can't stand like certain aspects of a certain wrestler. And this match just wasn't really there. I mean, they tried. I mean, they had Roman Reigns do a blade job, but you know, they were doing all they can to kind of sell this match. Huge deal that they were teasing the idea that Brock is going to leave the WWE. So they've been teasing that, you know, Brock Lesnar is going to leave for UFC, that his contract's going to expire. I mean, I think when it came to some of the end results of the show, I think a lot of people just weren't expecting like the obvious to happen. Like, they weren't expecting that, you know, that a certain wrestler was going to go over this particular wrestler when they feel that, you know, Roman Reigns, a lot of people thought that he was going to go out on top and become the new Universal Champion, and Lesnar was going to get a swan song. But it turns out that wasn't the case. They had moments where Brock Lesnar was trying to wear down Roman, giving him like F5 after F5 after F5, and Roman Reigns just kind of kept kicking out. It was basically kind of playing out that match from WrestleMania 7 with Ultimate Warrior and Macho Man, where Macho Man was giving him multiple elbows,
but Warrior kept kicking out. So they were basically trying to pull like an Ultimate Warrior out of Roman Reigns, but a lot of the fans just didn't buy it. A lot of fans were just chanting, "This is awful." They were chanting CM Punk, and just all this negative outcry that was going on in the stadium. But yeah, so Brock surprisingly went over Roman and retained the Universal title. It just pretty much, the pay-per-view ended very anticlimactic. Like, it's just something that was just very off. It seemed like Lesnar, turns out that there was a negotiations that Lesnar did renew his contract with WWE. And they're setting up a program or rematch at the Saudi Arabia show, which I believe they're doing just in a couple weeks. I think it's called the Greatest Royal Rumble. They're setting them up to be inside a steel cage. So it wouldn't surprise me if Roman does, however, come out on top and win the Universal title. Just a very uneventful match. I'm going to bring up the Undertaker versus John Cena, since I nearly forgot to mention this in my original recording for this audio. But these are the two of the biggest superstars to come out of the WWE, and they've been building this up for about a month since John Cena came up short in those two WWE title matches that he was involved in, whether it was the Universal title on Raw as well as the WWE title being on SmackDown. So he, using his free agent clause, which garners him the ability to go to whatever show that he would like to go to. So he gets title shots right out the ass, and he came up short in those two main event matches from Elimination Chamber and Fastlane. So Cena's just been kind of bummed that he doesn't have a match to be booked for WrestleMania. So he starts these sorts of petitions, or in a situation where John Cena keeps calling out The Undertaker, say that he wants a match, but if Undertaker doesn't accept his challenge, he's just going to sit front row, that he's not going to compete at a WrestleMania this year. And Cena's been kind of bringing about this, about how WrestleMania means everything to me, and you know, I'm not even on the show, and I don't know where I'm going to be in my wrestling career. Something to that effect. We do get our answer here at WrestleMania. And so Cena spent pretty much the first few hours of WrestleMania just sitting front row seat in the crowd, even had to chase a fan along the way. But Cena does, however, come back to the ring, and basically, while he comes out there to issue a challenge against The Undertaker. So then Elias Samson comes out and just basically trashes the crowd after a while, even though the crowd's pretty much really getting into Elias Samson ever since he got called up to the main roster. So Elias was just kind of trolling the audience, even to thinking that The Undertaker's going to come out, but then he just, you know, just being Elias and pulling all this heel heat, thinking that Undertaker is not on the show tonight. Yeah, he gets put in this place by Cena, and it turns out when Cena was just getting ready to walk backstage, the lights go out once again, only this time The Undertaker does, however, come out and uses his supernatural ability, and he does make his presence known. And without little effort, Undertaker just squashes Cena like a bug. Tombstone pile driver, 1, 2, 3. And the match was basically over before it began. Yeah, I mean, Undertaker, it seemed like the previous year, it seemed like he was going to retire, but then he came back out of retirement to challenge Cena, and pretty much decimated him in short order, really. Undertaker's definitely getting up there in age. You know, you can't really expect Taker to really go all out the way that he used to. You know, just given the history that Taker and Cena has had, you would think during the build-up that Cena would be kind of talking about The Undertaker and just how much, not only that he was an influence to WWE, but also an influence to him, John Cena himself as a wrestler. Because if you think about it, you know, when Cena came in, you know, he fought Kurt Angle, came up short despite looking like $1 million in that match. And then when it came time, when Cena goes backstage with all these wrestlers congratulating Cena's performance, and Undertaker also being that guy to, you know, earn Cena's respect. You know, if they brought that up more, and all the encounters that they've had, and you know, that if it wasn't for you, Taker, I wouldn't be where I am today. You know, if it was really more about just Undertaker being kind of like
the wrestler that Cena had influenced, that he is the reason why I'm where I am today, that I wouldn't have gone as far in the ranks in WWE, that I wouldn't have been the WWE champion, that I wouldn't be the poster boy of this company, or what, how have you. I just kind of wish they brought that up more in the build-up to the show. And because when they had like Cena just spending week after week after week just calling out Undertaker, and a lot of the times nothing happens, there's no story moving forward, it's just John Cena just coming off as an ass, begging for attention, it just makes him very dislikable. No matter what he does, he just doesn't respond, and there was just hardly any story that was moving forward. I think that was a problem with the build-up. We had to wait till WrestleMania to get our answer here. And, you know, Taker shows up, just does his job, just squanders Cena in short order. I don't know when exactly Undertaker's going to retire. That's going to be something that remains to be seen. It looks like as though that it seemed like in recent years that every year it's Undertaker's retirement, but a lot of the times it just doesn't pan out to be that way, that, you know, Taker's still wrestling. And I honestly don't know, you know, when's the end for Undertaker, but, you know, maybe WrestleMania 35 rolls around, we'll see what happens. But, you know, Taker just keeps on going and going and going. So, much respect. I mean, I'm not going to question Taker's decision whether or not he should retire, but, you know, it's definitely his decision if he wants to continue to wrestle. But, you know, I'm kind of curious to see how long Taker could really hold it for very long. So, you never know. But, yeah, so Taker just squanders Cena like the bug. Not really a match, really. It's not a match where you say it's a good match, it's a bad match. I mean, it was over before it began. I thought he was going to come back American Badass for a moment, but, you know, even though Kid Rock is being inducted in the Hall of Fame, I thought Taker was going to come back with the biker, just driving with his motorcycle, you know, dressed in these trench coat with a bandana. It turns out we did not get that, but Undertaker comes back under his classic dead man persona and completely destroys John Cena overall. Thank you all guys for watching. Leave a comment down in the comment section below. Just tell me what your thoughts about regarding this WrestleMania. Did you like it? Did you not like it? What were some of your favorite moments? What were some of the moments that turned you off while watching the show? Feel free to leave down your feedback in the comment section below. Thank you all guys for watching. And until then, this is the Gold Standard Caesar 924 signing out.